Gentlemen, let's broaden our minds. Lawrence?
Hello, and welcome to episode 37 of the Real Flicks podcast. My name is Mason Merritt. Joining me is Cody Redfield.
Hey.
And Josh Needle.
Hello.
We're making these introductions because we've seen a pretty big spike in our listenership thanks to The Conjuring 2, so welcome aboard if you're listening to us a new episode for the first time. Glad to have you. Just forewarning, I can be an asshole sometimes, but it's okay because I talk fast, so you'll get over it quickly. But yeah, we got a fun episode today. We're going to be talking about Finding Dory, of course, the big box office winner this weekend. We've got our top five Pixar movies coming up. And then, as always, ending the show with our watching, reading, listening to segment. I've got a good one for today. So, but before we get to that, we do have one bit of house cleaning before we dive into news.
Uh-oh.
Joshua, you and I made a gentleman's agreement of sorts.
Yes, we did.
In preparation for Finding Dory, you bet me that Finding Dory's final Rotten Tomatoes, as far as all critics go, will be below 94%.
I thought we believed
below
90%. Yeah.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
And let's just put it this way. It never dropped lower than 92.
No, it did not.
It sits at 94, certified as hashtag fresh as hell, like Smith. And you were extremely wrong. So before I quote...
You're real humble.
Very humble. I'm so humble, like Andy Samberg and Pops. before I do talk to you about what you will be doing, I just want an official apology from you to Pixar. So go ahead.
Sorry.
You're sorry for what?
Why are you sorry?
I was wrong.
Sorry. Are you sorry for doubting Pixar's mightiness?
We wait till we get to the movie for this part.
No.
Just say it.
I'm sorry, Pixar. I doubted you.
Thank you. And your punishment, in addition to 30 whippings, will be...
It's not really a punishment. It's kind of a reward.
That's true.
About it.
I guess so.
Because it's a great-ass movie he has to watch.
You're going to be watching Interstellar at some point before our next episode, and we're going to talk about it. So, no matter what... Independence Day Resurgence will not be the best sci-fi movie that you watch in the coming week, so...
Before we move on, I have to say something real quick. I did rewatch Interstellar.
Oh, you did? You already did?
About a week and a half ago.
Oh. Cool.
So good.
Well?
I don't like it.
You don't like it at all?
No.
Didn't give it a chance. Didn't even give it a real chance.
No, here's what I'm going to say. I watched it a week and a half ago because I knew I was going to lose. I was like, I know I'm going to lose this bet. So
break their spirit. Then their body.
I was like, you know what? If I'm going to watch this, I'm just going to watch it on my own terms. Because if I watch it after losing, I'm going to be watching it and feeling hateful towards it from the get-go. So I was like, all right, I'm going to watch this now while I'm feeling kind of positive towards it.
Liar.
Yeah, I'm serious. I watched it. Before I watched it, I rewatched the trailer because the trailer for Interstellar is incredible. It's a really fantastic trailer. It actually got me teared up. And
shut that dog up.
It's my neighbor's dog. So I rewatched it, and I was really in the mood. I was like, I'm gonna love this movie. And so the first two thirds of the movie, I was like, this is really not as quite as amazing as I remember the first two thirds being, but it's really awesome.
Mm-hmm.
And then the third act happens, and I almost hate the third act.
Why though?
Because it is so jumbled and it's so derivative of everything the previous two acts are leading up to.
So it's derivative of the movie?
Or no, not derivative.
Don't
wrong
you
word.
Want it to be derivative?
No, but like, not the, that's the wrong word. Like, it's going against what everything.
Okay.
Like, it's just. It's leading up to this one thing, and it's also just so it's really unsatisfying, and this didn't bother me the first time I saw it. I hate the ending. I really hate the ending. It's so just it's not satisfying. It just feels so wrong. And I don't know if I want to say much. I don't want to spoil it for people.
Spoilers for Interstellar. So you're talking about the ending. Are you saying when Cooper's in the Tesseract? Onwards or after that?
Pretty much onwards.
Okay.
Or actually a little before when he leaves, what's Anna Hathaway's character?
Brand?
Brand,
yeah. Once he leaves her, pretty much from there on, the movie goes completely downhill for me.
Now, what don't you like about it?
First of all, I don't like that as a character decision because it immediately makes him, turns him, goes, makes him someone who just wants to get back to his family, and now he's a dick.
How is he a dick, though? He's saving...
saved her life.
Yeah, he's saving humanity so she can go to the other planet.
Yeah, and he's leaving her behind. It's not like she's saying,
anything, he's leaving himself behind.
But it's not like she's saying, go, you know, go save humanity. It's fine. Leave me. She's like, no, don't leave me. And he's like, well, sorry, you know.
If he doesn't leave, then they're both dead.
He's thinking for the greater good.
Yeah, I think that. I thought that was pretty big.
I didn't like that. I understand why he did it, but I didn't like it. And then the other thing is, once he gets in there, then he gets into the Tesseract, and that entire sequence is just completely. It feels like a different movie. It feels like it goes from a sci-fi movie into a fantasy movie, it's not like it's like stupid or confusing. I understand what they're doing in the scene, but it's like okay, so now it's completely changing the rules of this universe because
I don't know if it's changing the rules of the universe, he goes into a black hole and nobody knows what happens in a black hole. Yeah, no one might have let his imagination run a little bit wild, but at the end of the day, it's science fiction.
Fiction part of science.
That's totally true. But up until then, the movie felt very.
So it's two-thirds science and one-third fiction. And you didn't like the fiction.
I didn't think it blended well, and I didn't think it was executed well.
All right, that's just a personal preference. Yes,
yeah, it's fine. But the thing is, I have a lot of good to say. I think the movie is his best looking movie by far. Mm-hmm. Like the cinematography by I can't remember his name. He did
Hoyt Van Hoytema.
Hoyt Van, yeah. Looks beautiful.
He did Spectre, so I don't know.
Of course you know him.
He did Spectre and Tinker Tailor, so the guy, he's like my guy. He's my favorite. I like him more than Deakins, TBH. Not that I don't. Deakins is a very close second, but Hoyt is just the man. I love him.
The scene of him when they're in the ocean on the planet and the giant wave coming up, which is really intense, by the way. Mm-hmm. That the water, just like the shots of like the grand like water and like everything, it just looks amazing. And then when they're on the other planet with Matt Damon, all that stuff looks amazing. And then the music, Hans Zimmer's music is fantastic.
So I want to hear, give me a grade for the first two-thirds of the movie.
For the first two-thirds of the movie, this is like probably like a 9.
Okay, now give me a grade for just the last third.
Like a 4. Christ.
So are you meeting in the middle there, or does the first two acts kind of outweigh the third act?
Yeah, I'm sort of torn still. I'm not sure what exactly I would give it.
You sound like you're at a 7 to me.
I don't. It's not a 7 because a 7 is to me. A 7 means I like it and I don't like it. But I'm not going to give it like a look. I can't say this is a bad movie because there's so much effort that goes into making this. There's no way I can say this is a bad movie.
Yeah, that's you're pretty much you with Interstellar is me with Civil War. I think.
Yeah.
Like our reactions to those are just pretty similar. Like you can buy some stuff, but others you can't. But like that's fine. I mean you can. You can dislike the movie I don't care. You can dislike whatever movie you want, but that's at least you backed it up, so which is nice. Because when you hear people just say, "Well, Interstellar is garbage," because
they don't like it because I didn't understand it.
Yeah, like
that's
4% of people who saw this for the first time understood it completely.
Yeah. Like, and most of them liked it. So.
Yeah, and granted, I think that you know movies should do their best to be good the first time you see it instead of the
another thing I have with it. Yeah.
Where
it's like it feels like it's also a movie where it's like they're kind of implying that you should see it again and again so you really get the full thing, and I'm just like, show me it once so I understand it.
But if you kind of just sit back and let the movie let it do its thing and you just buy what it sells, and I think you can enjoy it. It's much more enjoyable than if you really try to sit down and nitpick, which I think it's pretty arrogant that people are like, it makes no sense. It's like, unless you're an actual scientist, then shut up. Because I don't want to. If Joe Schmo goes to this movie and is like, the science is stupid, doesn't make any sense, then I'm just like, okay, that's fine, but you need to shut up because you have no idea. That's like me trying to critique figure skating. I don't know what the hell. I think,
yeah,
as far as I know, it's okay. I'm not going to be like, oh, well, her turn wasn't 360 degrees. It was only 355. Like, I don't know that shit. That's fine. So, I don't know. I get more upset with the people that just outright slam the movie just because they can. It's my second favorite Nolan movie. So, I guess I might be in the minority.
But there's a lot of people that really love the movie.
I love that movie.
Yeah, it's close to my top 10 of all time. So, yeah, I don't know. Maybe I was on a sci-fi kick recently, so maybe I'm just high on it. But, oh well. Cody, you love it?
Love it.
Awesome. So let's move on. Josh, your debt has been paid. I won't send Tony Gunk after you to break your legs yet. But let's move on to news for this week. We got a good amount of it, especially yesterday. So we'll end with DC. Let's talk about Star Wars for right now, just to kind of get Josh's spirits back up. So we did get we're getting a cover story from an Entertainment Weekly about Star Wars Ragu 1, and that's a joke, by the way. I'm not an idiot. Anyways, so Darth Vader's in the movie. I didn't believe it until I saw it. Now we've seen it, or it's at least on a magazine cover, so I doubt that it'd be false now. And the way that it's being made out to me is that he's in... It seems like they're insinuating he's not going to be in a lot of the movie, but he's going to have a presence throughout.
Basically.
Okay, that's fine. Are you guys hyped about that?
Yes. I'm okay with it.
Yeah.
I don't think that movie needs Darth Vader.
Yes, it does.
Nah.
You want Darth Vader, but does the story call for it?
Yeah, this is a story, like, what is it? Like, I think it's like a day before A New Hope.
A day, really?
I don't know. I remember I read something and said, like, it ends like 10 minutes before it.
Huh. That's cool.
But I don't know if that's true.
That'd make an awesome rewatch to double feature those two.
Yeah. And another thing is, like, once you watch this movie, you're going to, like, if you watch this, you're going to watch A New Hope immediately after. You're going to see Vader totally differently. Like, I think that's so cool.
Hmm.
Because if you watch this and you see him, because most likely you're going to see him, like, there's a scene where he's just on a beach, storming the beach, killing people left and right.
And, but like, then, if this ends 10 minutes, unless something happens to him, I just can't get past the fact that it's like, we saw the Vader in episode 3 is similar to the Vader in episode 4. And if they make him too, like, acrobatic, I guess, and just
I'm not saying he's not gonna be doing flips and stuff, like,
yeah, but just like, but like, just think of the Vader that we saw doing Obi-Wan in A New Hope or Star Wars, whatever you want to call it. He was just, I mean, yeah, it was like, kind of clunky.
He's just, tired.
There's only so much Obi-Wan can do either.
I know, but like, they're still just sort of moving their upper bodies, kind of like,
he was taking it easy on him,
maybe, but.
Like, did you see him, like, in Empire Strikes Back? He's, like, at a point, he was letting Luke have it.
Yeah. I don't know, that's just going to be a weird thing to me if he's going to be, like, Darth Maulin all over the place. But
That'd be awesome.
Maybe they might, you're probably right, Josh, he's just probably going to do some Force stuff, and then he'll throw a couple of lightsabers and kind of deflect some blasters and stuff like that, and just sort of do what he needs to do. But, like I said, the fact that the guy's only got one working arm, and everything else is robotics, just, it would be strange to me. But maybe it'll probably be awesome, because I'm just imagining Vader, like, coming, or just like, they're battling on the beach, and you see the sand bunker, and Vader just walks up to it, ignites his lightsaber, and you see, like, the other guys, like, recoil, like, oh gosh, they're, like, stepping back, they're all intimidated. So that'll be cool. That'll be really fun. But
yeah.
You guys are excited?
Very.
Trying to keep my expectations down in case I hate it.
True.
Why would you hate it?
It'll at least be good.
I don't know. You never know. People always thought that Phantom Menace was going to be a masterpiece too.
Yeah, but that was when George Lucas was involved.
Maybe I should have more hope that it won't be then.
I heard somebody actually say that they legitimately enjoy the prequels, like 8 out of 10 enjoy, and I about cried.
I liked them when I was 10.
Yeah, but they still do. They go, no, they're good movies. It's like, okay, no.
I mean, it's, if you like them, that's fine. I don't know.
That's fine. It's very strange. Also, we hear a little some more details about Jyn Erso that are kind of common knowledge, but there's no need to spoil it for anybody who doesn't already know. So if you want to look that up, then you're welcome to. But it's interesting, and, you know, they're gonna take her. Looks like they're gonna take her characters in some cool places. But the most interesting thing I think we found out was about Forrest Whitaker's character.
Oh yeah, I heard this one.
According to them, Forrest Whitaker's character is being described by EW as, quote, "Star Wars completists will recognize immediately when they see his name, even if he looks very different than the way they've seen him elsewhere." So, I don't know what to make of that. So, you guys throw your theories, and what is that? Where's your mind go to first?
Well, there's
Lando.
A character. No way, Lando.
That was my first thought, because he's the only black guy in the universe.
Exactly. It's Mace Windu. I got it.
I'd be cool with that. That would make a little bit of sense. I mean,
no. No, God, no.
Well, the last time we saw him, he was being, electrocuted and thrown out of the
building. He didn't die on screen, so...
Yeah. First of all, does Forrest Whitaker have his arms?
Well, first of all, if they were going to do it, just bring back Samuel L. Jackson. That would be... I would hate if they just recast him.
He doesn't want to do it.
He wants to... He has been campaigning to be brought back into Star Wars since they bought the company, so...
Yeah, we haven't seen Forrest Whitaker's arms. Because I know... Because Mace Windu did lose one, so... I'm putting my money on Mace Windu. What are you guys?
There's a character in Phantom Menace that I can't remember his name.
Captain Panaka.
Panaka, that's his name.
Oh, I was kidding.
No, that's who I was talking about.
Oh, really?
Cody, yep. You're on a roll today.
You're really good at this game.
But yeah, him. I think if it's been in a movie, that would be the character that makes the most sense because not to shine a negative light on Star Wars, but hasn't really been a lot of black characters ever.
We've got, five that we can think of. So that's not
five.
Bad.
Keep forgetting a Panaka.
There's a lot more white people, but hey, there's five. Five's a good number. That's enough for a basketball team, so sure, go for it.
But yeah, he was kind of the first person that come to mind because like anyone else would be like, no, that's not going to happen. But this guy is like, this takes place, Phantom Menace is what, like 35 years before this?
Yeah.
Something like that? Okay. Yeah. So he would be, Forrest Whitaker looks like he's like about 60. This guy was about 30 something.
Okay.
The age lines up. He looks kind of similar.
Does he? He lives though?
He's a soldier and he lives through the movies.
Okay. Well, the fact that they said not just Star Wars fans, but Star Wars completists, probably not Mace Windu, but I don't know. Yeah, that seems logical. But if they do, like, oh, it's if they like pull a Michael Jackson or something like that, it's like, oh no, it's this white guy. I'll be like, what? That'd be awesome.
Cal Katarn. That's my dream. I wish it was Cal Katarn.
Oh man, that'd be
it's a younger Finn. What? I actually did. I heard somebody explain to somebody else how that no, this isn't Finn and Rey. Like, the black guy and Jenners are not Finn and Rey. So that's scary. So the people like that are walking out there. Spooky. But any idea when we're getting another trailer?
Probably in next month.
Oh, really? Oh,
yeah,
for Star Wars
Celebration. Yeah.
We're going to have to do, like, before that starts, we're going to have to do a little preview of that to talk about what's coming.
Yes.
Because I'm very curious. I'm hoping we get some announcements. But one more little note is that Power Rangers has added... a meth dealer to its cast.
The meth cook, not the dealer.
The meth cook, excuse me. Bryan Cranston will be playing Zordon,
which is amazing.
The newest Power Rangers movie, and I don't know, I'm on board for this. I mean, Elizabeth Banks is a good start, but when you go like, oh, we're gonna get Bryan Cranston.
I just can't believe they're getting such like serious actors.
That's awesome.
Have you seen the picture of Elizabeth Banks in her costume?
Yeah, it looks cool. Yeah.
She looks cool.
Is she playing Rita Repulsa?
Yeah.
Yes.
They just need Lord Zedd, man.
I mean, I think I read somewhere that Bryan Cranston was in Power Rangers at one point.
Yeah, there's a video embedded in this article where he was snizzard. Sounds more like a South Park character than
it does. It sounds like a joke character.
Like the Hillary Clinton it. Snook. That's the snizzard.
It's a snook upper snatch.
It's a snizzard that replaced the snook. Yeah, that's awesome. Bryan Cranston's man. I'm excited for this movie. I think it's gonna be really cool.
I've had a complete turnaround on this movie. Like, I originally was like, this is going to be so stupid. I don't care about Power Rangers at all. Like, how do you do Power Rangers and make it, like, a good movie? And then they got the cast, and I was like, okay, I liked one of them. And then they got the costumes, and the costumes look so cool.
Mm-hmm.
And then they got Reed Repulse's costume, and now they have Bryan Cranston. And now they have that awesome poster that came out this morning. Like, it's like I'm kind of excited for this. I don't know anything about it. It's kind of cool.
I mean, I'm not expecting this to be like anything great, but yeah, I'm expecting it to be really entertaining and really cool.
Yeah.
So I mean, so I'm on board for this. I think it's going to be really cool. But and if in the long run, where they're like, oh, well, these kids' TV shows make great movie properties. If they can, if this means that we get a movie version of American Dragon, Jake Long, I'll be psyched.
That show was so cool.
Awesome. Like Gargoyles, yeah, that Gargoyles would be cool, but American Dragon, Jake Long, that's where the money is. Or Danny. You ever saw that show?
No.
Oh, it was really cool.
That's great.
I want a Rugrats reboot.
No. They're kind of doing that. They're doing a Rugrats, like a Nickelodeon like movie where it's like all the Nicktoons come together.
What?
But why?
I don't know.
Is Danny Phantom there? That's another one I want. Danny,
I don't know. I know it's like all the 90s cartoons.
My Own Worst Enemy, that episode of Danny Phantom, brilliant. It was my favorite movie of the year that year. I don't know. It was cool, though.
Movie of the year.
It was really dramatic, though. It was kind of messed up. I loved it. But yeah, so Power Rangers, March 24th, 17, should be great. Nice. But of course, before we get into our main conversation, the big news is that we got some information on the Justice League movie. Which apparently is only going to be one, or is at least going to be standalone and not part of two movies, which, I don't know, I'm kind of bummed about, because, like...
Well, it was always going to be that.
We didn't know that. Like, Marvel did the same thing. It's like, oh, it's not going to be Avengers 3 Part 1. It's going to be Avengers 3 and Avengers 4, like, separate things. I like splitting a movie into two parts. That's just, like, Harry Potter, Deathly Hallows Part 1 and 2. It's awesome. One big movie, one big story.
I like it when it's necessary, but, like, really, that movie was long as hell.
Yeah.
If they made Deathly Hallows into one movie, it would probably have been worse than it was.
But my whole thinking throughout this was that, like, Justice League 1 would see, it would go through whatever, and then it would leave on a Superman cliffhanger where, I don't know, he busts out of his coffin. Doesn't seem like that's going to be the case, so.
Oh, well. If he's not back in the first 15 minutes of this next movie, I'm going to be just shocked.
So some things we found out are that that Justice League will take place a few months after BVS, and so it's being acted as one movie. Batman, he feels something is coming, so the bell has been rung, obviously. So he puts together the team to protect the Earth against a possible threat. And in the movies, MacGuffin and kind of the acting as the Infinity Stones of this universe, there are these mother boxes that people have to get to something. I don't know. Do you guys know anything about this?
No.
Yeah, I don't understand. It's... Who cares? Steppenwolf is going to be the villain. We saw him briefly in a deleted scene to Batman versus Superman. I thought he looked pretty cool. We got, like, the horn head and all that kind of stuff. Know nothing about him. But they have an actor who is pretty close to signing on, but they can't reveal him yet because he's not 100% all the way there. So let's do a little bit more hypothesizing. Who could be playing Steppenwolf? Do you guys have any ideas, any thoughts?
Andy Serkis? I don't know.
I don't know who Steppenwolf is.
I don't know anything about him.
Apparently he's like Darkseid's uncle, which is...
Let's look it up. We have the entirety of human knowledge right here.
Isn't that amazing?
All I know is he's related to Darkseid in some way. I don't know.
Steppenwolf, Batman v Superman. Let's take a look. What?
He's just all right. Guy.
It's this guy from Pan's Labyrinth. Okay. I thought he was gonna be a wolf. I was gonna make a joke saying it's gonna be played by Taylor Lautner, but
get out.
It's not as funny anymore. God, he looks really cool.
Yeah. My first thought, actually, when I heard this, was like, I don't know why, but I thought of Armie Hammer. I don't understand.
Armie Hammer.
Yeah, like when I first like, oh. I just saw his face and was like, yeah, he'll probably play Steppenwolf. So maybe I'm right. Maybe I'm clairvoyant and like Lorraine Warren, and it's gonna turn out to be true. But
you don't want that though. Her life sucks.
That's true. But
I have no idea. I honestly have no clue who could even play that. Josh Elba. There we go.
And Josh, any idea? Any thoughts?
I mean, just get a motion capture, because they said it's not. I heard somewhere that they're just gonna do a voice actor, and then it's gonna be completely CGI. And not, like, performance capture or anything.
Oh,
so,
okay.
But I don't know if that's actually what they're doing. But, I mean, if that's what they're doing, just get, like, someone with, a deep, menacing voice. Like, get James Earl Jones. I don't know.
Michael Cera, yeah.
Michael Cera. Hey, guys, we gotta find this Earth. I'm gonna take it over.
Why is my? I'm not a wolf, but my name is Steppenwolf, guys.
Steppenwolf, but I'm not a wolf. How do you get Ellen Page pregnant? How's that even work?
Have you seen Ramon anywhere?
Hey,
nice. Seven evil exes? What? There's seven Justice League members? Oh, no. Anyway, and then apparently those, like, the parademons and Batman's flashback or whatever sequence in Batman v Superman, apparently they play a big role, which is cool, I guess.
It sounds like they're basically, like, they're the Chitauri.
Yeah.
Like, from Avengers.
Because everybody needs to have henchmen. Everybody needs to have henchmen. There's a funny Family Guy bit once about henchmen, like the school of henchmen or whatever, and it's just these guys like shooting each other. It was funny. But William Dafoe is also playing a guy named Vulko, which is, I guess, Aquaman. Yeah, one of Aquaman's bros.
What'd you just call him?
Vulko?
No. The actor.
Oh, Willem Dafoe.
I thought you said William Dafoe. I was going to get really upset with you for a second.
Willem Dafoe!
It's Willem.
How many mother reference or anybody needs it? But yeah, that's kind of a waste of talent. I don't know. I'd like him to be somebody fun.
Well, I mean,
like, a waste of talent.
They can make the character good.
But like, hear me out here. So you know how, I don't know, maybe I think it was insinuated in the movie that Lex Luthor was not like Lex Luthor. He was like his son. I was hoping that William Dafoe was going to be Lex Luthor Senior.
So you mean he was just going to play Norman Osborn again?
Yeah. Yeah, that's you saw
Spider-Man. Man.
You saw right through me. I love his Norman Osborn. So
take this city over.
Yeah,
just join me.
Also, Zeus is apparently going to be in the movie. So Liam Neeson confirmed.
All right, cool.
Yeah, because I heard
Clash of the Titans. Just
I read that there's going to be like a sequence similar to like Lord of the Rings. Like you know how they have that like a million years ago. Thing this happened and then they flash forward to like present day. I feel like that's what they're gonna do with that.
Huh, that's cool. So apparently Batman was hit really hard by the death of Superman and didn't feel like he honored him while he was alive.
No, for the day that they actually knew each other.
Yeah, maybe he'll name his daughter Martha. Junkie XL is doing the score without Hans Zimmer, so might as well watch the movie on mute.
Junkie XL
was garbage.
No.
Well, that the score to that movie, except for the Lex Luthor theme, was crap. I hated the score to that. It was
the Hans Zimmer stuff was good, but like the Wonder Woman theme sucked.
No, the Wonder Woman theme was the best
part. Oh, no, I hated
Wonder Woman. Wonder Woman was cool.
That had Junkie XL's fingerprints all over it.
Yeah. You didn't like the Mad Max score?
I liked the Mad Max score because it fit the universe, but had music from like Man of Steel that was great, but you can't just throw another composer on.
Yeah. Well, if Junkie XL, whenever he sees a bass drum, he just breaks out into a cold sweat.
Whenever he sees a guitar, he's like, I'm just going to do that scene from Mad Max again.
And
let's get the guitar guy.
Yeah, the Batman theme is horrible.
Yeah, the Batman theme is boring as hell.
It's not, wow. No, it's not boring. It's just, unlistenable.
But it's just, I think it's like not bad. It's just like so boring. It's just like dun 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 dun.
Well, think about it this way. So we start off with Danny Elfman doing the Batman theme, which is like
this is good. This is good.
No, it's like this grandiose. It's like huge, and it goes a bunch of different places. Then we get to Nolan, where Nolan's with Hans Zimmer. It's kind of like it's a da 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 da, which is like okay, that moves fine. This one is just it's just
noise.
It sounds like a cat walking across a keyboard, and they're like, it's perfect. It's perfect.
Hans Zimmer's cat.
Yes.
Franz,
best cat ever. Mm-hmm. Give me a. I can't.
Even I name it. The kitty Franz over my brother.
You're good. So Flash and Cyborg apparently are going to be like the comedic relief, I guess.
That doesn't surprise me.
Which makes because this movie is being described as a little more sardonic humor, a little more irony as far as Batman goes. He's on a man. He's a man on a mission. So the big takeaway is that this is going to be a lighter tone.
Which makes sense to me.
It makes sense that they're going to want to lighten it up after people hated Batman Superman for how dark it is, but I didn't expect them to. I thought they would stick to it, but I guess not.
Because it's like, I feel like they said months ago that this was going to be a lighter movie than Man of Steel and Batman vs. Superman, because it's a Justice League movie. Like, does anybody really want or expect, like, a movie about a team of superheroes coming together to be dark and depressing?
I don't know if I want it, but I expected it.
The story to Injustice is pretty dark.
Yeah.
Well, that's like an Elseworld story that takes place after the team has been assembled for years.
Put it in canon. I want the whole thing.
I thought you didn't like Injustice.
Oh, I didn't like the game. I liked the story. I don't like fighting games.
So apparently there's going to be more of detective work by Batman, which is nice. So yeah, this movie's got more room for humor, which is, so it's kind of, it's not being tied to like Dark Knight Returns or anything like that. So they're trying to make it fun, which I think is just, no, that's fine, I guess. Oh yeah, as far as the Batman solo movie goes, apparently Affleck doesn't have a script that he's 100% happy with, so that might be on the shelf for a little while. But he's currently working on it, so we'll see how that goes. Batman has a new suit. Did you guys hear about this?
Yeah. It's a new armored suit, right?
Yeah, and apparently there's another one that's kind of like a more basic suit, and it's got some blue in it, apparently.
Ooh. That'd be, I like that. That'd be cool.
I don't know about that, but that's...
Back to his roots.
Yeah, and then we got more of the classic-looking Commissioner Gordon. So J.K. Simmons, he had a hat on, a tie, long trench coat, glasses, so I'm still hoping he doesn't have hair, because that's just a very little thing that upsets me. Batman, apparently we're getting more vehicles, which is really exciting, with that because toys. There's going to be something called the Flying Fox, and then the Nightcrawler.
I was really excited
about
that.
Either of those have anything to do with bats.
That's true. They're not just for Batman, but I guess they're
for the team.
Yeah.
It reminded me of X-Men.
The X-Jet?
Yeah.
The Flying Fox apparently is like a 3-story ship, can hold Batmobile and a bunch of other Batman's stuff, which is cool. The Nightcrawler is apparently massive. It says, imagine the main part of the Batmobile, except where the wheels would normally go. You have 4 spider-like legs from the largest spider you can imagine. Is this John Peters or something? They allow the Nightcrawler to climb and move in ways a car or a plane can't. Apparently they're going to... That's... Okay, that's cool. Sounds a little silly, but I guess that's what they're going for. Nothing else too crazy. Just sort of kind of schematics of it. What are you guys excited about? What are you guys excited about seeing?
I don't know. I mean, like I said, I wasn't really excited for Justice League and for a while. And then, the Geoff Johns thing and the Ben Affleck thing happened. And I was like, okay, maybe something could be good. I'm still nervous. After hearing all this, I'm like, okay, I'm starting to get back on board. but, we'll see. It's still a Zack Snyder movie. So the storytelling still is in question. Mm-hmm. But everything I'm hearing sounds pretty awesome. So... And they described, I don't know if you read this too, but they described like a full scene or 2 full scenes, one between Batman and the Flash, and then one between just the whole team talking to each other, and just hearing their dynamic and like how they talk to each other just sounds right. Sounds really fun, and I'm excited to see that. So,
mm-hmm. Cody,
I'm reserving. That's how I'm going to start playing my life from now on. Is reserving nice. Excitement until I actually see the thing. But yeah, it sounds okay.
Yeah. I don't know. I'm gonna see it. But I could give a crap about the Justice League, to be honest with you. I really think the only superhero I care about is Batman. So if that's just me. That's just me. The Flash is, he's cool, Cyborgs, whatever. It's going to be a movie. I feel like I feel like this is a very familiar thing where it's like, oh, we're hearing great stuff. And then when the movie comes out, it's going to be like one of those 43%, what's happening situations. I don't see any reason to be excited for this. I don't know. This is boring. I'm bored with the superheroes, team ups.
How did we get back to the place where I'm excited for Justice League and you aren't after I didn't like Batman v Superman and you did?
Life is a time is a flat circle, John.
Right now, we're just speculating.
Yeah, I mean, this.
There's no hard evidence that we're gonna like or dislike this movie.
Yeah, all the movie players are back from Batman v Superman, so I don't know why people are getting so psyched about this, because it just seems like they're putting on a different outfit, but the person in it's still the same. So it's I don't know. It's just.
I mean, especially the one that really got me interested was. There was one article from someone who hated Batman vs Superman, like, more than anyone. And he was impressed with what he saw.
Well, it's what he saw, but he didn't... It's not...
Yeah, I know.
You didn't see the movie. You just... I know. Yeah. Everybody kind of is at least in as much of agreement as they can that Snyder has got an eye for making something look good. Yeah. But the story's obviously... That's the tricky part. So, you can tell me how awesome this gadget is and that... you know, moment or that set piece is, but is the movie going to be good? That's the question.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that we don't...
And we won't know until we see it.
Yeah, be as excited all you want, but this is, again, we got to temper expectations, because it's just, because once this movie comes out and it's not going to be what people try to build it up to be, then it's going to, everyone's going to get all pissy again. I
know.
I get annoyed by that. But
like the tone after Batman v Superman came out, I was kind of annoyed.
Yeah.
The tone wasn't my big problem. It was the
not the tone of the movie. The tone of everybody in Hollywood.
Oh, well, yeah.
It's such a dumb movie. It's so stupid.
I did see a tweet that somebody said, oh, it's official. A team-up movie with a rabbit and a fox made more money than a team-up movie with Batman and Superman. I was like, well, there you go. Because Zootopia is awesome.
That's the world we live in.
Yep, we're here. It's great.
Did you guys also see the logo?
Yeah, it looks fine.
I like it.
It's a logo.
It looks old school.
Looks great. Be great on a t-shirt.
Yes, it would.
Or like a car decal. I'm serious. That's not a joke. It would look sweet on the back of a car. But all right. Well, any more DC talk?
No, just one other thing. Non DC. So we had a passing of somebody.
Oh yeah, that's right.
In the Hollywood world, our world, Anton Yelchin was in a car. I don't know if you can say it's a car accident.
It's a wreck.
Yeah. Essentially from what I could gather, his car, he got out of his car, which was on some kind of an incline or a decline. And it pretty much pinned him against a wall or a fence which is just horrible.
That sounds terrible.
Fun fact, yeah. Jeep was actually under recall, so good job, automakers.
Guess who's getting sued?
Yeah, probably. So that sucks.
Yeah, I thought he was a really great, underrated actor. Way too young, so.
Absolutely, real bummer.
Mm. See, I wanted to end this on a high note, but...
Thanks a lot.
But now, we're all missing
you. Gotta bring the mood back up.
Gotta bring the mood back up. So you guys want to hear something that happened to me at the DMV yesterday?
Yeah. Sure.
No, I've never met at the DMV.
Okay.
I went twice, sorry. But yeah, rest in peace, Anton. We'll miss you. We got a few more movies, but they're all gonna be
good.
Yeah. So Star Trek Beyond, that's gonna be an emotional watch for a lot of people, I'm assuming.
I hope they do something like they did in Fast and the Furious.
Oh, well.
Somehow.
Yeah.
I don't know how they'll do it.
Maybe a little late for that, but I wouldn't.
Well, they already finished the movie.
Maybe it'll look better than I did not like that part of.
Mm.
Really?
Fast and the Furious. No, the CG was awful.
I thought it was great.
It was tough. But regardless, let's talk about something happy. Let's talk about Pixar. Let's talk about Finding Dory.
My family! They're out there somewhere. I have to find them.
I'm shocked and surprised that anybody in their right mind, just throughout the process of this movie, has called Finding Dory a cash grab. Because it's not. I don't understand. In a world where we have Marvel and DC who make 7 billion sequels, that we get mad at Pixar for making a sequel to a movie that is, I think at least, has had the biggest cultural impact since like Star Wars Episode 4, maybe. Maybe even of all time, I think.
Well, you can see their point when the sequel comes out 12 years later.
Yeah, that's...
And it's banking on nostalgia.
I don't know so much, but I just...
It's a kid's movie. Do you think any of the kids that saw that movie ever saw Finding Nemo when it was in theaters?
If their parents are good parents, yeah.
Well, I mean, it was 13 years ago, so they weren't alive. But I'm sure... But, like, Finding Nemo is... It's one of the. It's like a classic. It's all time classic. Everybody likes it. It's on that. It's just on that Elf kind of level where just kind of everybody's pretty much seen it just at one point or another.
It's Pixar's golden age.
Yeah, I've never been to a beach and seen seagulls and not immediately thought or heard someone say mine or something to that effect. Or it's. I love Finding Nemo. It's one of my favorite Pixar movies and
one of my favorite movies.
Let's talk about it. So. Finding Dory, initial thoughts, Cody Redfield, let's hear.
Loved it. I had a stupid smile on my face the entire movie.
Mm-hmm.
Ellen DeGeneres is amazing in this movie, and just all the characters that they introduced, like all the new people were great too,
mm-hmm.
all of the familiar people. I don't think, was that the same voice of Nemo from...
No.
Sounded pretty close, though.
It couldn't have been, I was going to say.
Yeah, that kid was like, he's like 20-something now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it sounded good, though. I really liked pretty much the entire movie, including the dumb little animation we got at the beginning of it.
That was great.
That was heartwarming. Warming.
I was waiting for something bad to happen. I really
was.
Me too.
I thought the world was going to end. I thought it was the beginning of the movie. I'm like, what's this have to do with Dory? But I was pleasantly surprised. That was just so sweet. Mm-hmm. I kind of got diabetes after watching it.
True. Same.
But no, I enjoyed pretty much this movie from beginning to end.
Me too. Josh, initial thoughts?
Well, I went into this movie, it's not a surprise, I wasn't dying for a Finding Nemo sequel, because Finding Nemo is my favorite. It's one of my favorite movies of all time. And for some reason, it's just one of those rare things where I'm like, it's perfect, and I don't think they can do anything else, so just have a Finding Nemo and do other sequels. But I was wrong, as we were shown from the Rotten Tomatoes bet. And I was stubborn going into this movie, and I came out in tears, holding my heart in my chest. It was amazing. I think Finding Dory is a fantastic movie. I loved every second of it, and I'm happy that it happened. So
nice. Just like me, I love Finding Nemo. I mean, that's probably the Pixar movie that probably 99% sure it's the one I've seen the most. So granted, I've never been negative on it. I've been super psyched to see this. It's just been something I've been waiting for, because I don't see anything wrong with adding another movie onto this, because like Josh is apt to say, the original's not going anywhere. There's nothing, and Pixar, yeah, they're not the kind of studio that would make a bad movie. I mean, I'm pretty sure they know that Cars is not good.
Yeah.
Okay. I was gonna say Cars 2.
Yeah. John Lasseter's like, okay, I know the Cars 2, Cars and Cars 2 are not the best things we've done.
But
they make a lot of money. Okay. They're not hurting anybody. So
the thing with Cars is they're John Lasseter's like baby. So even if they tank with make no money, they're still gonna keep making them.
Oh,
so
I didn't know that. But but with Finding Dory, I see it the same. I feel like if we had this kind of internet culture back in 1996 or whatever, people would say, oh, we don't need another Toy Story 2. Toy Story 1's awesome. What do we need another one for? And I feel like we're fine. It's 13 years late. I'll give you the point there. But these still are the same characters that we know Pixar is going to do the right things with and tell the right story with. So there's never been a doubt in my mind that this will not be a great, great movie. And it absolutely delivered. I loved it. I think it's on par with Finding Nemo. I think it's just as good. Granted, I still like Nemo more, but that's just for nostalgic purposes. But this movie stands shoulder to shoulder. And above all, I think that even if Finding Nemo never, if Finding Nemo never came out, I think this would be like a humongous success for Pixar. And this would be like, oh, well, Pixar, they've done it again. If it was just Finding Dory, the same movie, but you just take away Finding Nemo and you can only kind of hint to the stuff that they talked about, I think it would be just as highly regarded as Finding Nemo is. I think it's one of the best movies they've had. I think probably their best. Well, what came out first, Incredibles or Nemo?
Nemo.
Okay, I think it's the best movie they've had since The Incredibles. I love it, and I could not have been more satisfied. So some further thoughts. So let's talk about just the story in general. So, as they talked, I think they only mentioned in a line of dialogue in Finding Nemo, Dory, she doesn't know where her family is. So this movie, she gets reminded of something, and she's like, oh, I have a family out there. I got to go find them. And they go off on an adventure to, what was it, a marine biology park, so she can go and find her family. So what did you guys think of how this, the plot and the story unfolded?
It's fine. It was organic enough.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't seem like they were just pulling it out their ass and just saying, oh, we gotta do this. We gotta find some way to get them going somewhere. Mm-hmm. I feel like this is an actual thing that if fish could talk, they would actually have to deal with every once in a while.
True.
Because people are the worst and can't leave fish alone.
Yeah. Well, to be fair, this time around, she did have the thing around her, so I get why they grabbed her, but whatever. Doesn't vilify people too much, which I always,
that was
I always
good.
Enjoy. Josh, how'd you think about how the story and plot was dealt with?
Well, I was worried that it was going to be just a straight up Hangover 2 where it just rehashes the entire first movie. but I was really happy that it wasn't. And I'm mad that the trailers made it look that way to me. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I thought the story worked really well. It really got me emotionally. And every time Baby Dory came on, I cried. It just works really well, except for one part of it that's a little, we'll get to it later, but it's a little out there. But overall, I think it works really well. All the characters work together well. The story is just really well crafted. I think Andrew Stanton, with both this and Finding Nemo, just tells the story really well, just from scene to scene, from the opening scene to the very ending. It just does it really well. So I liked it a lot.
You mentioned that scene, so so spoilers for Finding Dory. Let's talk about it now. What scene was out there for you?
When the octopus and Dory are driving the truck.
That was awesome.
That was great.
It was fun, but it was like it's even for like a movie where fish can talk. Like, it's a little crazy, but didn't
Buzz Woody drive the Pizza Planet truck? And
that is true. Didn't think of that.
I don't know.
It's canon that they can do that.
Yeah, toys and fish can drive, as we know. Plus, he's a septopus. He's got seven arms to get to that stuff. I thought that was silly. At the same time,
you need to remember this is an actual kids movie.
Yeah, I was about to say that. I'm more than willing to give him that the benefit of the doubt there when it comes to a kids movie. So I didn't catch the Pizza Planet truck, by the way. I was trying to find it, but I couldn't. I saw this twice, and I couldn't find it either time. Very upset with myself. But anyways, let's talk about the voice cast. So, of course, Ellen DeGeneres is back just as good. She hasn't changed at all, but it's only her voice, so I don't know how much it would. But yeah, she's still great. Albert Brooks was back as well. He did sound a little bit different, but still
sounded older.
Yeah, he sounded like Marlon. But this movie takes place a year after, by the way. So let's talk about the main trio. So Dory, Marlon, Nemo, especially the newcomer Nemo. How do you think that they did reprising their roles?
They were great.
Good. Mm-hmm. Yes, I agree.
I especially liked the new kid. Was it Hayden Collins? He sounded the same to me. I don't know.
Just like him. It's good. That was a good choice.
Yeah.
I could tell he was a little... I've seen Finding Nemo enough times where he's definitely a little bit different. He sounds a little more kiddy, I guess you could say. Like, I mean, he worked. He did a great job. So
I watched Finding Nemo the night before I saw Finding Dory, and it didn't sound different to me at all. It was weird. It's like, is that the same kid? Did they cryosleep him the whole time? that's fine, though. But some other newcomers, Ed O'Neill played Hank the Octopus. Caitlin Olsen was Destiny, the whale shark. Ty Burrell played Bailey, a beluga whale. And we also got Diane Keaton and Eugene Levy.
That was Diane Keaton?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. I didn't even realize that.
As spoilers, Dory's mother and father.
Wow.
Diane Keaton and Eugene Levy were the parents.
I knew it was Eugene Levy, but I didn't know it was Diane Keaton. I didn't recognize her. Well,
yeah, me too. I didn't recognize either of them. And the second time I knew who they were, but I was like, I still can't. Who are these people? But also, we also got Idris freaking Elba.
Did we really?
Oh my gosh. Yeah.
Yeah, he was one of the SEALs.
I did not get that.
Yeah,
awesome.
I wasn't sure
incredible.
If it was him.
He was the bigger one.
That was one of my favorite scenes, was with the seals.
Me too.
Stupid ass looking seal would ever try to get onto the rock, they'd go bananas on him.
Gerald,
get off!
I thought that was really funny. Gerald and Becky were just great. And my mom's name is Becky, so I was like elbowing her the entire time when I took her to see it, because we love Finding Nemo. And it's like, Becky's just this very strange, crazy-eyed bird. It's like, it's you. You, mom.
Look into her eye. You got to get in sync with her.
But I think the real shining star of this movie was Sigourney Weaver. Of course.
Thank you, Sigourney Weaver.
Hi, Sigourney Weaver. She played just like the voice throughout the aqua park or the Marine Life Institute or whatever like that. And she's just so random. I had no idea that was going to be a thing, but it was a thing, and I thought it was hysterical. But So of the other newcomers, of like the main, you know, Destiny, Bailey, who'd you guys like? Who do you think brought the most?
The octopus.
Hank, yeah.
He was so funny.
Mm-hmm.
Ed O'Neill's great.
I
love him.
Get out of here. I loved every part of it.
Yeah. Those scenes especially, just on the rewatch, I just love the chemistry they had between Dory and Hank was just so funny. I related to. When I first saw it, when he was like after the tag, I was like, is he the villain of the movie or something like that? Because he was kind of being a dick, but it's just like, oh, once you get further enough, it's like, oh, that's just who he is. And that's just him. That's just Hank. He's a bitter old man. But another thing, the animation.
Oh, great.
It's fantastic.
Oh, God.
Phenomenal.
So back in Toy Story 1, or not Toy Story 1, and back in Finding Nemo, they actually...
Wait.
I'm still thinking about the car because I want to talk about that. But apparently when they did Finding Nemo, they did their animations for the water, but they had to like scale it back because it looked too real. And apparently that like freaked people out or confused people or something like that. So they had to make the water a little bit less obvious. This time I thought it looked pretty legit. Like, maybe it's because the rest of the animation kind of caught up with how good the water looks, but it looked like it was real water. It was amazing, is so hard to animate. Like it's almost impossible, but they just do it without a problem. So that looked amazing. What else did you guys think about about the animation?
Everything just looks beautiful.
It looks amazing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Especially there was the end credits, the shot that was panning up during the credits. It was just that alone was like amazing to look at.
And another spoiler alert, just please don't listen to this. So pause this right now. Do you guys see the final credit sequence?
Yes, I did.
Cody, did you?
When was it?
At the very end.
No.
Oh, okay. Well, do you want us to spoil it for you?
Yeah, go ahead.
So this whole the final credit shot is just it's like as Josh said, it's sort of a pan up of the ocean. When they get to the very top, the fish from Finding Nemo in the dentist's office, they were still like rolling around and they had like the algae. Of course Jock's thing was perfectly clean, but everybody else was kind of like messed up, and they kind of rolled into the Marine Life Institute and were picked up and saved, which was really a really sweet scene. And Gerald finally got the rock, which was great. I don't know. Wait, no, he didn't get the rock. He was just kind of like...
He was hiding.
Yeah, he was like bouncing around. He just came out of the water and he was just... Oh, I love Gerald. Gerald's a man. I relate to Gerald. But that was a really... That was a great way to bring back those characters, I think, to make them go full circle. Like, I think this is probably going to be it. Because I feel like they've told everybody's all the characters' stories. Everybody's had their conclusion.
They're not going to complete the trilogy with Finding Marlin.
Marlin.
I don't think so.
Yeah, I don't really want.
But
I don't think Marlin's lost anything in his life. He has nowhere to go.
True.
He's such a scaredy cat.
Yes, his wife was killed by, you know, a giant, sharp-toothed fish.
It happens.
That's another. Glad you bring that up, because another thing that I noticed, and I watched some behind-the-scenes things from Finding Nemo, is that their initial plan for Finding Nemo was to pepper in the flashbacks of what happened to Marlin and Nemo's family throughout the movie.
Yeah.
But then like they were told, like, no, you just put it at the beginning. It'll work a lot better at the beginning, because people won't like Marlin because he's so annoying, and you don't understand why he's that way. So they did it for this movie, where they did pepper in the flashbacks throughout the movie. So again, coming full circle, do you guys think that worked with when Dory kind of heard words or
the cues that made her remember things? Yeah, yeah. It made sense for the character because she was remembering them for the first time. And here we are watching this movie for the first time.
True,
we're remembering it.
Yeah, they didn't happen too often, or they were handled poorly. You guys liked them?
They were handled fine.
I thought they worked really well,
and they always made sense.
It's true. It did make sense. What else do you guys? What else does you want to talk about? What else did you like about the movie?
A couple of things. The first, the opening scene that I mentioned before, just the whole like where she, you know, is with her parents, and again, baby Dory. I just want to talk about baby Dory forever. Baby Dory is the cutest thing that I've ever seen in my life. But there's the scene where she's talking to her parents. And, you know, she's counting and they're doing hide and seek. And then, you know, she's like, what if I forget you? And then like all this stuff. And then it builds from there, and it builds into the beginning of Finding Nemo.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought just all that, and it builds so well. It was really, really clever. Really, it worked really well. It met at the right moment. And then the movie goes from there. I thought all that was done fantastically.
Right.
And then I just, everything with, and another thing I really loved is that they took, Because in Finding Nemo, Dory forgetting things was basically comic relief. But in this movie, it was, like, the heart and soul of a lot of, like, the emotional stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought the way they flipped that around was so sweet. I really loved it.
Me too.
See?
Cody, anything else? What do you want to talk about?
I really liked the beluga.
Yes. Ty Burrell is great.
It's so good. It was just so funny. All of their scenes, the scenes between him and the shark.
Yeah, Bailey, Destiny.
Or Destiny. Or
Bailey. Yeah. Played by Bailey Sweet D.
That's hilarious.
Shut up, bird.
I wish that joke had come up once.
Yeah, me too.
Shut up, bird.
When is Charlie Day going to get a Pixar movie? Come on.
Probably tomorrow. Soon.
Like, he is the best. But anyways.
Let him be in the Incredibles sequel.
Ooh, the villain.
What if he's the villain? Oh,
oh my God.
Right.
That'd be so cool. That would be a really good idea. You're on fire, Cody. You really are. Look at you go.
Fuck around.
Jason Lee was the villain for the first one, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be great to have another comedian do the villain this time.
Was there even an antagonist in this movie?
Nope.
That's why I liked it.
Yeah. It's refreshing to not have to deal with like a Winter Soldier or a shark. Well, yeah. Not that there was really a villain in
a bad guy shark.
Actually,
I mean, those three sharks were always on their case.
But they weren't really villains. They were just they were just following their nature. I guess Darwin
and they're heroes by the end of the movie.
Yeah, true.
I guess Darwin is the real.
Well, she kind of is. She's the one who killed everybody. She's fucking hate Darla, the bitch. I was really hoping for like a Darla death scene, TBH, but maybe if she got hit by the truck or something, that would have been nice, but we all know
that would have been too dark.
Well, not dark enough if you ask me, but, there's just a few, one of the things I like about a lot about these movies are just the little details. Like one of my favorite parts of the movie was how, in the very beginning when you saw all the manta rays singing, cause you got the manta ray from the first movie, Mr. Ray. And then when they come through for their migration, they're just like, it's like the Soviet national anthem. They're just, it's majestic as fuck. They're just like, it's great. So I love little things like that.
So, thank you for throwing in the Soviet national anthem.
Well, man. I listened to that multiple times since you recommended it to me, and it's awesome.
And it's amazing,
it's
right?
It's so cool. It's like, I would go to war for them just by that anthem. Like, let's go. Let's fight. Who are we going to kill, guys?
Let's go for the motherland.
Let's fight, man. But, yeah, so that was a great touch. But let's talk about a little bit about the comedy of the movie. So what tickled your funny bone? What did you like about the movie?
There was one joke about sex that was really funny. When a mom and dad love each other very much.
Dad fish.
Yeah, that one got me really. That was really funny. I love when they do like adult humor that kids don't get.
I think they get it, even though
kids probably get it because it's been used a million times, but
they get it, but they don't know what it means. Yeah. They just know it's supposed to be funny.
That mom and dad love each other very much line just makes me laugh no matter how many times it's been used.
As long as it's, if you do it in a different way, because obviously everybody knows the joke. So if you can mess around with it, in this case, fish, with somebody that forgets, it's like, oh, we're talking about that.
Yeah. It's just everything. It's just I love the way Pixar handles comedy because they don't really have. I mean, sometimes they do, but they don't usually have like just straight out gags. They write their humor naturally into the movie, and it just flows from the characters, and it's funny. It's a really funny movie. I was laughing a lot.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think a majority of the comedy for me came from. Well, I guess a majority of it came from Ty Burrell because I just
He was funny.
He was great.
And the seals as well, and just some of the, little things were just. I was always laughing throughout this movie. Like when Hank is the goat. By the way, he's the greatest of all time. I love him.
Oh, absolutely.
When he's holding Dory and he's carrying her in the coffee pot. And I can't remember how he says it, but he just says, no, nobody's fine. Like when somebody says they're fine, they're lying. And he walks over and the guy answers the phone. He's like, oh, hi, I'm fine. How are you?
Yeah.
He's just like, oh, yeah, of course. Like, Pixar, you know how full of shit people are. That's great. It's perfect. And just kind of how he was able to change into different things. Like when he became the plant, I thought that was really cool.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's just there's so much little stuff that just sort of snowballed into just being this being one of probably the funniest movie I've seen the whole year. I loved their comedy is so sweet without ever being anything close to mean-spirited, and and as somebody who likes mean-spirited comedy and insult humor, I can't help but respect them for just making me and anybody that watches this laugh. It's just I doubt anybody can come out of this movie and just be miserable. It's stupid. Yeah, I loved it. Any other particular scenes or sequences you guys want to touch upon?
Not that I can think of it. Just as a whole, well,
just the whole movie.
Yeah, just it's great. It's so good. I just loved every second of it. One other thing is the music by Thomas Newman. Mm-hmm. It's one of my favorite musical scores of all time in Finding Nemo. And it's not as good here, but I thought it was great here. And I just had to say that the one time they used the Finding Nemo theme, they used it for that one scene where Dory, Marlin, and Nemo are just like talking about her parents before they go on their adventure. Mm-hmm. And it was amazing. And it made me feel nostalgic. So
yeah. So let's talk about our favorite scene in the movie. So what...
God.
Yeah, sorry about that. But can you...
Favorite scene in the whole movie?
The whole movie.
Fuck. Somebody else go.
mine's the reunion scene. Just when Dory is...
Oh, that was great.
In quarantine. Oh. From Dory, getting swept away in quarantine... And ending up back in the ocean, I love that scene.
I almost cried when she met her parents again.
Yeah, so. I low key did, but that's okay. Nobody heard that, right? Okay, but just when she's moving around and you see the callbacks to the beginning of the movie where she's like she needs help but she doesn't know what she needs.
Yeah,
there's just a scene where she kind of just calms down. She's like, "What would Dory do? What would Dory do?" And she looks like, "Oh, there's sand over there. There's kelp over there.
Like sand.
There's this sand." Like, I hate sand. Anakin, I hate sand. She just looks over the kelp. Yeah. She just looks over to the kelp, and I don't know why this affected me so much. She's like, no, kelp is better. I don't know why. I still can't figure out why I love that so much, but I do. It's like, no, kelp is better. It's sort of like philosophical in a way. It's like when you're looking at nothing and something, but the kelp is better. Like, the options are better. I don't know.
Something is always better than nothing.
Yeah. I don't know. I just can't stop thinking about just that little moment. It might have been just a throwaway thing that they didn't intend to be important, but it was important to me. So, and then when she kind of goes through and she sees the shells and just the image of the, what was it, like the, it was like a pipe or something like that that her parents were obviously living in, and the shells going out in every which direction, that's one of the best pieces of imagery they've ever come up with. So that's definitely, and then, of course, her reuniting with her parents is broke my heart, but. Rendered it at the same time, which was great.
I'm going to go ahead and say that's probably my favorite scene, too.
Okay. Nice. Josh, do you have a...
Aside from just everything with Baby Dory, who's the cutest thing that I've ever seen, I would probably say the whole prologue scene, pretty much everything leading up. Again, like I said, everything that builds up to meeting Marlin. I thought all that was just amazing. I love that.
Yeah, it was really... There's no wrong way to go with this one. I mean, especially seeing Crash and Squirt. That was great.
Yeah, that was awesome.
So great.
The one thing I was a little bummed about that we didn't have a cameo from the sharks. I really wanted to see them.
I feel like that might have been too much.
I know, but I wanted them.
maybe if they, well, I guess you couldn't see them in the flashback or else they'd recognize Dory. But, yeah, I love the sharks. They're great. But, yeah. Anything else you guys want to talk about?
The movie's amazing.
Yeah.
As a whole, it's a really, really solid, great movie.
Pixar has done it again.
Damn them. Just fuckers. Share your talent. Like, come on. It's not that hard.
Stop hoarding it. It's mean.
Really. Low-key evil. But all right, let's give it a grade. Cody, start with you.
I'm going to give it an 8.5.
Really?
Yep.
Okay. Fine, you go higher. I'm going 10. Josh?
I'm gonna go 9.5.
What? What? 9.5?
Yeah, it's a great rating.
But it's not a 10.
Yeah, but you can't just throw 10s out everywhere.
I'm not throwing 10s out.
I'll actually amend mine to a 9.
Okay. So we're the same ratings as Conjuring 2. Anyways, but
is it really?
Yeah, literally the same. Come on, guys. No, that's all right. That's just. We all love it. So, interesting. I'm coming at the highest 3 weeks in a row.
That's so weird.
How about that? Awesome. So let's move on to our next segment. We're doing this afterward just in case our ratings were changed by this movie, or at least mine were. Let's talk about our top five favorite Pixar movies. So I'm going to start off with a couple honorable mentions. Toy Story 3.
Wow.
It's that low because I just can't say that I like it as much as the other two, because I've only seen it that one time, and I've never really wanted I've never really wanted to go back and watch it. I don't know why I've only
seen it once too. It's okay.
I've seen it like 15 times.
Yeah, it rubs me the wrong way for some reason. Maybe eventually I'll probably do a Toy Story trilogy, just sit down and watch at some point.
Well, don't do that. You'll have your heart ripped out.
Well, you talk about pain like it's a bad thing. but I remember enjoying Toy Story 3 quite a bit. Maybe I'll get around to it watching it one of these days. But another movie, my other honorable mention, Inside Out, just came out last year. I loved it. It's so funny. And the fact that it's 6 out of 13 movies, and I still would probably definitely give that a 10, just goes to show how great Pixar is. So Inside Out, just barely missed.
Are you sure Cars isn't on there? Because Cars 2 is my number one.
Okay. That's fair. Cody, any honorable mentions?
A Bug's Life.
Oh, nice.
Very underrated.
Shit, never mind.
So underrated.
I actually put that on my list.
What's that? That movie's 8.5, and it's my second and least favorite. I hate it. Ah, they're so
good.
You
really hate that movie?
No, it's an 8. It's
oh,
an eight
you
and
hate
half.
It as in...
Yeah.
So, actually, I'm taking that one out because that's actually on my list. Or wait. Nope, it's not on my list anymore. So yeah, Bug's Life.
Nice.
And that's about it. And I'm going to preface by saying I haven't seen
Inside Out?
Inside Out or WALL-E.
Okay. Oh my god, you have to see Inside Out. Don't see WALL-E. WALL-E isn't good.
What?
What?
I don't like WALL-E.
You don't like WALL-E?
WALL-E's my second least favorite.
WALL-E's great. I love WALL-E.
I don't like it.
Wow, that's savage. Anyways, Josh, honorable mentions. Let's hear it.
Ratatouille.
Okay.
I think it's a really great movie. And then I guess another one would be Finding Dory.
Hmm. Okay. So my number five to start us off, Finding Dory.
All right.
I loved it. We just talked
really?
About it.
Did so. You like it? I couldn't tell.
I did. Ten
I thought
eight.
You were kind of cool on it.
No, it's fabulous. I loved it so much. So we'll move on. Cody, number five.
My number five is Ratatouille. Okay. I love that movie. It's hilarious and heartwarming and French. it's a good movie. It's fun.
The strangest Pixar movie I think that's ever been made.
I agree.
Which is fine.
Which is why I like it.
I watched for the first time a few weeks ago. Really cool.
Nice.
Really cute. Love Remy. Patton Oswalt needs to do more voice work.
Yes.
He's awesome. He's the best. Cool. Josh, number five.
All right. Before I start my list, I just want to say I'm sort of cheating on my list, but not really. And I'll explain what I mean when I get to a certain number. But I'm not really, but I kind of am. Okay. So my number five is Monsters, Inc.
Okay.
It's a great movie, and I've seen it a million times, and Boo is amazing, and Mike and Sully, I love them. And the voice work is great. Animation's great. It's an amazing movie, and it's hilarious. So
nice. My number four, Finding Nemo.
Whoa.
Yeah.
I thought that would have been higher, to tell you the truth.
It's like I said, Pixar. It's only number four because it has to be four. These are all like my number one through my number six are all. They could all be number ones.
Interchangeable.
Yeah, they're all great. So
in no particular order.
Well, I have to have a particular order. I do prefer some to others. But I love Finding Nemo, like I said. Seen it countless times. We'll see it countless more. Can't wait to show my cats this movie. Actually, one of my cats did watch it, and he was fascinated with it because all the fishies.
Because he wanted to eat the fish.
Yeah, but then he fell asleep, so it's like, okay. Maybe when you're older, buddy. Cody, number four.
Number four is Monsters, Inc.
Hey.
I love that movie. I love John Goodman's character in that movie. He's amazing. I love Sully. I love just the whole story of it. It's just great. It's so heartwarming is a word I'm going to say a lot during this episode because that is heartwarming.
Well, it's more setting your heart on fire and then eating it. So, I don't know. Steve Buscemi is Randall Boggs. Probably the best Pixar villain. Yeah.
I agree.
Even better than Syndrome, I think. It's close, but... Yeah. Awesome. Josh, number four.
My number four is The Incredibles.
Whoa.
This is actually like one of my favorite superhero movies ever. It's an amazing movie. I love the characters. It's really mature. It's probably one of Pixar's most mature movies. And it's just, I mean, it deals with a lot of stuff. And it's awesome. And it's so much fun. And I love every second of it.
My number three, The Incredibles. Like you said, I echo everything Josh said. It's phenomenal. It's just perfectly made, perfectly constructed. The animation is just fantastic. I mean, the volcano room that Mr. Incredible goes to, so good. And it's hysterically funny as well. Like, oh, it's great. And yeah. Featuring Edward Nygma as Syndrome. very similar. I love it. I love Brad Bird's one of my favorite directors. I love this guy with everything he's done, whether it's animation or live action. So between this, Ratatouille, Tomorrowland, Iron Giant, and Mission Impossible, this guy is just so great. He's every movie I think his worst movie I think is Tomorrowland, and it's very, very good, which is an unpopular opinion, I guess.
Yeah.
So you can direct whatever you want, man. I'm on board, and I can't wait for Incredibles 2. It's another I see that movie was made. It's going to be made at the same length of time as Finding Dory, but people are going to be fine with that as a sequel.
Because I feel like that's a movie that's more lending itself to a sequel, though.
The story's over.
But it's like it's a superhero movie.
Yeah, I don't know, but I love Los Increíbles. So I had to watch it in Spanish in school one time, and it's the best day ever. So Cody, you're number three.
Incredibles. I got nothing else to add. It's great. It's amazing. There. Okay, Josh, you're up.
Okay. My number three is Inside Out.
Whoa.
Yeah. I
didn't think that'd be that high.
I love Inside Out. I saw it 3 times in theaters. And yeah, I love this movie so much. I think it's probably their most intelligent movies. I love all these characters. Bing bong.
No spoilers. No spoilers.
Please relax.
I didn't say anything. I just said bing bong. But it's so amazing. I love every second of this movie. Riley is a really great character. Great female lead character to mention too. Unlike another Pixar movie. And it's awesome. It's just so much fun. Cody, seriously, watch it as soon as you can.
It'll happen.
You gotta watch it.
I'll try.
It's fabulous. That main the theme of Inside Out, the musical theme, the piano. I love that.
Yeah, it's great.
So good. Yeah, fabulous. So my number two, my next two picks kind of do fit, and they sort of belong where they belong. My number two is Toy Story 2.
Whoa. Okay.
I love this movie. My parents are not quite sure, but I'm 93% certain that this is the first movie I ever saw in the theater. So, and I've seen it countless times after that, and I just love what they did. I mean, with the Prospector and Bullseye and Jesse, and then the Collector. I mean, I think it's a perfect sequel.
It is as perfect as a sequel as you can get.
Yeah, pretty much. Like it's
basically The Empire Strikes Back of movies about toys.
Well, close.
It's the Dark Knight of Toy Story.
Yeah. The Attack of the Clones of Toy Story. But
wow,
no, savage. It's I love it.
I liked it.
I think it's so great. It just gives me the heart feelings. I think it's far more emotional than, at least for me personally, Grant, I've seen it a lot more times than Toy Story 3 is. I just the themes that it touches on, and it breaks my heart. But like I said, it mends it, just like all these Pixar movies do. They never leave you on a down note. They always leave you on a happy one, and which kind of gives them license to emotionally attack me as much as they want. So my own worst enemy there. So yeah, Toy Story 2, my number two. Cody, number two.
My number two is Finding Nemo.
Oh.
Great movie. Love Finding Nemo. Love everything about it. Love it from beginning to end. Love all the characters in it. Love all everybody. Love everybody. Love it. Fucking love it. I've watched that movie so many times, and it's great every time that you watch it. These guys are—they're too good, and it kind of pisses me off, like you said earlier.
Yeah, low key, like I said, my rankings 1 through 12 are all 8.5 or higher, and then there's Cars, which is like a 7.
Cars
1's fine.
Yeah, I like Cars.
I don't even want to watch Cars 2.
Cars 2 sucks.
I know how horrible people say it is, but Josh, your silver medal goes to
Toy Story 3.
Okay,
so I'm going to explain for a second. I didn't want to just have, because if I would have made this list completely accurate, I would have had 3 Toy Story movies on here, and I wanted it to be a little more diverse. So I just picked my favorite Toy Story movie, and that is Toy Story 3. So I really love Toy Story 3. I think it's it's the culmination of all 3 movies. It's fantastic. Everyone comes back and they're better than ever. It's just, the story is great. It's the most emotional of all of them. The scene where they're going down into the pit, into the trash compactor, or the trash,
the incinerator.
The incinerator, that's what it's called. Yeah. Yeah, it's just that scene where they're all holding hands and they're just like accepting their fate. Like, that scene killed me. Everything about this movie is perfect to me. At one point, this was my number 1, but then I rewatched another movie, and now it's my number 2. But I love this movie so much. It's amazing, and you both should watch it again.
Maybe. Probably.
It'll get there.
Yeah. It's kind of like when you have a dentist appointment coming up. Like, you know that it's not going to be a completely, like, it's not going to be a great time, but it's one that you just sort of have to get over.
It's not going
to
be that bad either.
True. But anyways, my number 1, one of my sayings in life is that just because you did it first doesn't mean you did it best. But in this case, I'm going to contradict myself, because my favorite Pixar movie is Toy Story. I can't logically give this title to anything but Toy Story. I think it's a perfect movie. It's the animation, even though, like I said, from 1995, so it's 21 years old now, just looks,
my God, so old.
Yeah, it looks stupendous, and it's perfect. It really is. It's one of my favorite movies of all time. I will never stop watching this movie, and I love it more than my heart can take. So, Cody, your number 1.
This is also Toy Story.
Oh, hey.
It's the original. It's one of the best movies I've ever seen in my life. You've heard me on multiple occasions on the show say that Toy Story is the best Pixar movie. Mm-hmm. Right?
I actually forgot about that.
I've said that too. More than once.
Well, I didn't want to spoil it for myself when I heard you.
It is the best Pixar movie ever made. It'll probably always be the best Pixar movie ever made, because this is the movie that started it all.
Nice.
There's a reason that people love this movie so much.
Yeah. And I usually, I'm not showing it. And I'm not the type of person, I should add, that I really don't care. I don't give a movie that much credit if it starts a trend at all. Because I feel like with most trends, they were just kind of bound to happen eventually. I mean, we were going to get a superhero movie, like, franchise or whatever eventually. It's just it's a big property and it's good business. But with Toy Story, it's just like, God damn it, you guys perfected the formula the first time you did it. It's like, come on, they literally make everybody else look like a schmuck.
They really do. Yeah. They make themselves look like a schmuck sometimes too. That's the thing.
That's true. But yeah, Toy Story, great. Josh, your number 1.
We all know my number 1. It's Finding Nemo.
Brave. Oh.
But yeah, Finding Nemo, I've said a million things about it. I don't really see it much. It's perfect. It's a masterpiece. It's one of my favorite movies. It might actually, I don't have a top 20 or top 10, but if I did have to make one, there's a good chance it would be in there. I love Finding Nemo so much. So,
by the way, that's an episode that'll be coming eventually. So,
oh my God,
you better get ready. Better get ready. Not for a while. You got some time, but those are the plans. So great. So Toy Story, and Finding Nemo are our favorite Pixar films. Films, not movies.
Films. They're all films.
They're all films, except for Cars 2.
Cars and maybe Brave. I didn't see.
So what, do you have any Pixar blind spots, or have you seen everyone?
I haven't seen, what have I not seen? There's two I haven't seen. I haven't seen Brave. No, I think I might have seen Brave, but I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Whatever. I just don't remember it.
I feel you, bro.
how many are there? There's 17, 16, something like that?
Yeah, 16. Okay. Well, I haven't seen Monsters University, which I need to get around to.
That's really good. It's really good.
I've heard it's perfectly fine. And I haven't seen Brave and Cars 2. Just like I said, I just don't see the point in seeing Cars 2 especially. Brave, if I catch it on like what's ABC Family now? What's Freeform?
Freeform.
Yeah, if I catch it on Freeform, God, horrible name. I'll probably sit down and watch it, but it's nothing I'm gonna seek out. So.
Oh, I also haven't seen The Good Dinosaur. That's the other one.
Oh yeah, that one too. Did that even happen? Yes. Did that movie even come out?
I don't.
I guess
that movie's not canon.
Yeah, nobody cared about that. That's so weird because like everybody loves dinosaurs.
I heard it was good.
I heard it wasn't.
I mean, I heard it was just like not great. It was just good.
Didn't make that much money. Yeah. Only $331 on a $200 million budget. Yikes. Cody, any blind spots?
Wally, Cars 2. Let's just look. I have a list.
Inside Out.
You know. Inside Out. Good Dinosaur. Yeah.
You need to get to work.
I cannot believe you don't like Wally, Josh.
I just, you know what? I haven't seen it since it came out, and I just remember being really, really bored. So maybe I'll rewatch it.
Well, how old were you? When I came out.
I don't know, like what, 14, something
like that? Yeah, your brain was mush, so you gotta your consciousness was like mashed potatoes, so you gotta go watch that one again.
All I remember is it came out, I think, the same time that Get Smart came out.
Wow.
And I liked that movie more.
By the way, I know I put you on the spot a while ago, so I'm gonna do it again because it's fun for me. Sophie's Choice situation. Would you rather have BB-8 or Baby Dory?
Oh, Christ.
BB-8.
Oh my god.
Yeah, same with BB-8.
Finding Baby Dory.
Whoa!
Oh, yeah.
You.
Okay,
so your favorite movie of 2015 wasn't Star Wars, and you'd rather have Finding Dory over BB-8. Bro, are you even
Star Wars? Do you even like Star Wars?
Do you really even like
Josh, it? It's okay. You might. It's okay if you made a mistake the first couple episodes and saying you like Star Wars.
He's too caught up in the lie.
He meant Star Trek the whole time, but accidentally said Star Wars.
But Baby Dory is so cute.
But BB-8, when he gave the thumbs up, he's rolling around, he's squeaking.
But those eyes, and that voice.
But that eye, and that squeak. I don't know. I just think you're a hypocrite and a horrible person, and he wants you to die. So.
You obviously don't even like Star Wars.
I don't just go to Star Wars just because it's my favorite thing ever.
I bet you used to call them lifesavers instead of lifesavers, because I didn't do that.
I've never done that.
I did. I did all the time. So great. Awesome. So wow. Pixar, he's great.
Yes.
Let's move on. Let's do a quick watching, reading, listening to. I've got a few, so I'm going to start here. I went and saw Warcraft. It was all right. It's not. Great. It wasn't bad. It was cool. There was a lot. There was just a little bit too much, and I guess it's because I don't know the characters. But there's just a lot of like, oh, we got to go to Drankor's, the castle in Kabakistan or whatever. And it's like, oh, what? Who? What? Well, once it got into a groove, and once they sort of cut the fat out and focused on like the three main storylines, I was like, okay, this is. There's nothing wrong with this. It's fine. It's acceptable, and it's you can make fun of it. there's actually this one scene where my friend and I were watching it, and we were the only ones in the theater, so we were just Mystery Science Theory-ing the crap out of it and just making fun of it because it's that kind of movie. there's this scene at the end where there's a portal that like is going from the battlefield to this other place, and so the portal starts to like close or whatever, and so these people are trying to get out, and they're being swarmed by the orcs or whatever, and this one guy just bails, and he runs through the portal as it's about to close and just, like, leaves everybody. Made me laugh so hard. But, it's a perfectly fine movie. I don't really like it. It's just, it was too stupid in parts, and like I said, I just didn't, the first hour, I just kind of was in a state of, okay, let's hurry it up. Come on, I don't care about this. Let's go. But, you know, it's not that bad.
Better than the Rotten Tomatoes score, you have to admit.
Oh, absolutely. I think it's like a 5 out of 10.
I'd give it a 6.
It's fine.
I loved it.
Would you give it? Did you give it?
I'd give it like, I mean, I didn't really, but I give it like an 8 something. Okay.
That's fine. And last night I rewatched one of my favorite movies of all time that I don't think I've ever talked about in the show, and I don't know if you guys have seen, so I doubt it, but maybe you have. It's called The Game. Anybody heard of it?
I know it's a David Fincher movie.
But... it's David Fincher's second movie, where if I was back in time, if I was went back in time and was a theater goer and a movie goer in the 1990s, and I saw Fight Club, I would write this guy off, because Fight Club is, I think that's an awful movie. But
what's
The Game,
an awful movie?
I hate Fight Club so much.
You're the worst.
I'm sorry. I don't like
the only person in the world who doesn't like that movie.
That's his best movie.
Alien 3
is his best movie.
I don't like smug, condescending movies. I get enough of that from myself. So I hate Fight Club. But anyways, on to the movie. I do like The Game. The movie he made right after, I think. I might have the timeline wrong. Sorry if I do. I love The Game. It's one of my top 20-ish favorite movies. I love it so much. It's a very simple thriller, but it does a lot of really interesting things, and I feel like if it was released nowadays, you would get the trolls would be all over, because there are inconsistencies with the plot here and there, and there is some amount of just like, oh, well, if this doesn't happen, then that doesn't happen, which people like to jump on nowadays. I don't understand it personally, but I think it's a hell of a ride for a movie. Michael Douglas is great. Sean Penn screams a lot, which is nice. And I just think I think everybody has that movie where that you like force your friends to watch. Mine's The Game. And I love it so much. That's a 10.
Wow.
So I highly encourage you guys to watch it. I don't think there's really anybody that's going to spoil it for you, because it's sort of been lost in time, but it's definitely worth a watch. It's like 2 hours long. It's perfectly fine, streamlined, and I think it's very entertaining, especially when you're watching it for the first time. So if you do, let me know and we'll talk about it. But all right, Cody, what's next? What do you have?
What have I been doing? I also saw Warcraft. We didn't talk about that last week, did we?
No, I don't think so.
I also saw it. I liked it. It was okay. Shit. Sorry, I'm playing Tetris and it's not going my way.
Oh boy.
Let's see. I just started watching Veep on HBO.
Oh, nice.
And that show's really, really funny. Trying to.
You know, you should start watching House of Cards. Like, so with every you watch Veep and then House of Cards, like back to back, to kind of like balance it out. That'd be fun.
And I hate politics even more. I don't know. It's a really funny show. Just, they keep calling the president POTUS, and I love that. I don't know why I love it so much. I just think it's funny. Let's see. That's pretty much it. I'm still playing a lot of Dark Souls 3, but...
and hating every minute of it?
I'm loving every minute of it so hard.
While hating it. Yeah.
Yeah. It's weird.
It's an abusive relationship. Like,
yeah. I just can't leave it.
Very poisonous. We'll get you some help.
I'm just trying to fix it.
Josh. What have you been watching and listening to this week?
Well, in case anyone didn't know, I went on a trip
to
St. Louis, came back a couple days ago, and on the trip had a DVD player in our van, and I spent pretty much the entire car ride watching a lot of movies, but one I wanted to talk about in particular, it's my second favorite comedy of all time, and it's called Spaceballs.
Merchandising.
I see your Schwartz is as big as mine.
Wait, let's watch the Spaceballs VHS to see where they went.
What's happening? This is now. What do you mean? Right now on the movie is now in real life. This is weird.
Oh my gosh. Josh, what do you love about Spaceballs?
Fucking everything, probably.
Josh?
We killed him.
We killed him?
What
do you love about Spaceballs?
Oh, it's great.
Where'd you go?
Did you die?
Sorry.
Thank you. Are you shooting up heroin again? Told you to stop that.
Stop that.
Yeah. Yeah, loony. Anyways, talk about Spaceballs a little bit.
It's hilarious. I don't know. It's
doing heroin.
really becoming a problem.
It's a parody back when parodies were funny. And it's making fun of my favorite movie of all time. So, I just, it's, it's great. I mean, the actors are great. Rick Moranis is Dark Helmet. It's amazing.
He's the GOAT.
You have the president from Independence Day as Lone Star. Everything's what's his name? Barf. The actor's name?
John Candy.
Yeah. You guys want to hear a fun fact?
Yeah.
What?
My sister is going to a wedding in a couple of weeks, and guess who's going to be there?
The
Bill dad. Pullman. Yeah.
Nice.
Bill Pullman.
I think he told us something about him.
Yeah. Cody and I both know his niece.
That's right.
Do we?
Well, I do. Do you know?
I don't know. I might.
Katja Pullman?
Oh, seriously?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Your 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon just got a lot shorter, my friend.
Wow.
Yeah, so who would you rather vote for? Hillary Clinton, Donald Trump, or President Scroob? The image of him is like, oh, would I lie? And then he sort of looks off to the side.
The salute in that movie is my favorite thing in the world.
Scroob.
I bought the Blu-ray for that, Blu-ray steelbook for that for $4 the other day.
I bought the DVD of it at Walmart for $3.75 yesterday.
Nice. I was just fist bumping the whole way home. I was like, yes, Spaceballs.
I got that. I bought that and District 9 for $8 altogether.
Okay.
I so still great. Like Neil Blomkamp, so.
So great. And I still like spoof movies, so there you go.
I don't, because they're all terrible now.
Well, they were. Now they are, but I still stand by Scary Movies 1 through 3. I think those, especially 3. 3 is hysterical.
No, 3 is the one where they went to PG-13 and it got even worse.
Well, that's my sense of humor. I like it. But speaking of sci-fi and Bill Pullman, next week, Gosh Month mercifully comes to a close. Just kidding. I think I enjoyed most of it.
I think you liked all of it.
Yeah, I like
Oh, except for...
Yeah, what was the first one?
Teenage.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So it's going to... The middle was fine. It's like a roast beef sandwich with pieces of concrete as the bread, I guess. But it's his month, so we'll let him eat his cake. But next week, Independence Day Resurgence. Really excited about that. Stands at a whopping 46%, so lower your standards now and just hope for a good time.
The first one has like a 60. It's like, did anyone expect it to be high?
No, of course not.
To be fair, with like Rotten Tomatoes, Red Dawn has like a 30% on it, or that's Metacritic or something, and that pisses me off because Red Dawn is the best movie of all time.
So is Hook. Hook's only 32. That's crazy. Is it
really? That's stupid.
Yeah, that's really... They get it wrong every now and again. But then again, Birdman's 94%.
Because that movie is amazing.
Further proving my case that Rotten Tomatoes is hashtag flawed. But anyways, Independence Day Resurgence. Really excited to talk about that one. But until next time, you can follow us at _RealFlix on the Twitter. Send us an email, realflixpodcast@gmail.com. And once again, if you're a new listener and you like what you heard, and we know there's going to be a few of them with this one, leave us an iTunes review. Tell us what you thought, what you like, what you didn't like, and how stupid Josh is for not loving Interstellar. But again, probably in the minority, but that's okay. So until next week, take it easy, you guys.
Bye, everybody. I love Baby Dory.